Well, this is so discretionary fund.
I have two quick announcements. Wow, all of them, stop that. First is a note of gratitude. We have a really large music library up here, and I wasn't able to say this last week, but this is niece Leah has been helping immensely to catalog it, to make a digital spreadsheet, some spreadsheet, a digital version of this library, so I can try to share with other folks, for example. So it was a huge help and something she undertook last May and did all through the summer. And I'm very thankful for that. Also, the last thing is just a quick reminder that also on the 14th will be is our last final concert. I didn't ask Sue to put it in the announcements this week, but our final concert of the fall, which will be in here, is the second Sunday of the month, November 14th at 3 p.m. Thanks. Bye.
O God, we hear your call. But all around us, we hear the cry that there is not enough for all, and that some are undeserving.
Again and again, you call us to love you with our whole heart, understanding, and strength. Such love demands that we seek justice for those who are oppressed, poor, and forgotten.
O God, we hear your call. But all around us are competing calls of worldly loyalties, political parties, and public acclaim.
Again and again, you urge us to seek you first. We long to trust the path of love for you and our neighbors as ourselves.
Yet we fear that our land of milk and honey has become a land of moral famine and economic hardship. And we wonder at times if you have abandoned us.
Again and again, you urge us not to lean on our own understanding, but in all your ways to acknowledge you. And yet
we are often distracted by the clamor of fear dressed up as reason.
As we prepare our hearts and minds in these days, you remind us to follow you, so that it may go well for us, our neighbors, our nation, and our world.
You're beautiful. We can do that, so
that'd be good.
You can use this after you've done your lighting. I'll
Thank you.
are in joy and felicity. We praise and magnify your holy name for all your servants who have finished their course in your faith. And we most humbly pray that at the day of resurrection, we and all who are members of the mystical body of Christ may sit on the right hand and hear the most joyful voice, "Come, you who are blessed by God, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." Grant this, O merciful Creator, for the sake of Christ Jesus, our only mediator and advocate. Amen.
Good morning. This morning's scripture reading is Mark chapter 12, verses 28 through 34. One of the scribes came near and heard them speaking with one another, and seeing that he answered them well, he asked them, "Which commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength.' The second is this, 'Shall love the Lord as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.'" Then the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and besides him there is no other, and to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as himself. This is truly much more important than all the great offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You're not far from the kingdom of God." After that, knowing there, he asked many questions. Here ends this morning's reading. May God add a blessing to the power and send you these words.
Lovely reading. Thank you, Gerard. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O God, my strength and my redeemer. It strikes me so funny just listening to Gerard read that when Jesus says, "Oh, you're not far from the kingdom of heaven or kingdom of God. You're not far, but you ain't there yet," in other words. Today is Reformation Sunday. It's kind of ironic to have All Saints Day and Reformation Sunday so close. A seeming Catholic ritual, a day of remembrance, an acknowledgement and healing for some, will seem to others as anathema to that austere Protestant perspective. And the ritual itself can represent exactly what Martin Luther was railing about in 1517. When, as legend has it, he posted his 95 theses on the door of All Saints Church on October 31st. A mystical world guarded by an elite class, the priests, bishops, cardinals, the Pope, special people mediating with God on the people's behalf for a price. Luther never set out to create a split in the Roman Catholic Church, just as Jesus didn't set out to create a whole new religion. Luther wanted to reform the church, to empower everyday people, just as Jesus wanted to empower everyday people. But the church didn't want to be reformed, and Luther was ultimately excommunicated in 1521. Luther called the church out on practices that he felt were far from the roots of its faith. He looked back to the Bible, evaluated practices, and took things back to what he felt would be less corrupt. And in a way, isn't that what Jesus is doing in today's reading? When Jesus is teaching and preaching, he was reforming Jewish thought. He was steeped in the traditions of the prophets, Elijah and Isaiah. At Sinai, Moses received the Ten Commandments from God. By the time Jesus was on the scene, the commandments had grown from 10 to 613. And the religious authorities studied and were experts in the law. They taught the regular people about them, guided them in their practice, guided them in ritual. The Sadducees, the Pharisees, and the scribes, they were all pretty comfortable. They, as it were, just as the religious authorities of Luther's day, held the keys to the kingdom. 613 commandments. Through Jesus, boiled down to two. You shall love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. And second, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Period. That's quite succinct. And that takes the power away from the religious authorities, and it gives it to the hands of the people. Just as Martin Luther's 95 theses threatened to take away power from the religious authorities in his day. As the church, our belief systems are under constant reform. As a member of the United Church of Christ, we really embrace reformation, change, and re-examination. We are, after all, a church which believes that God is still speaking. That implies a church that listens to God's voice in our world, not just listening to the voice of the ancient world, not just listening to the voice heard in Luther's world, but in the world we live in now. We're to look, we're to study, we're to interpret the gospel. We're to look and study and interpret God's movement in the world around us. It is specifically not static. It's fluid. We appreciate that the community that Jesus calls us to be is one struggling to love the other, struggling to understand the other, and standing with the vulnerable. We acknowledge our relationship to the status quo, and it calls us to undergo constant reformation. In this morning's reading from Mark, Jesus responds to a question from a scribe. In the preceding scene, Jesus had been questioned by the religious authorities on taxation and on resurrection. Or, if you're a feminist like me, you might say it has less to do about resurrection than it does about the ownership and the role of women in society. The question asked by a Sadducee has to do with a woman who has been married more than once. It was the practice in the ancient world that when a woman's husband died, that she had to remarry. That was how property was managed. She was usually married by her husband's brother. In the resurrection, the Sadducees ask, if there's such a woman who has been married multiple times, whose wife will she be in the resurrection? Very important stuff. And of course, Jesus says what we all want to hear, no one's. We're beyond marriages in the kingdom of God. Ours is a God, Jesus says, not of the dead, but of the living. According to Chad Myers in Binding the Strong Man, the Sadducees reflect the highest of the upper socioeconomic class. They were not interested in everyday people. They were not interested in peasants, farmers, and fishermen. And they taught their own conservative theology designed to keep and maintain the status quo. We can imagine the problem they had with Jesus. So they and other religious authorities set out to trip Jesus up. And it doesn't work. And indeed, one of the establishment, a scribe, has been listening to this discussion and liking what he hears, puts another question to Jesus. What is the greatest commandment? You shall love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus throws the second one in just for good measure. It's kind of a two for one. The scribe agrees, "You are right, teacher. Love God and love your neighbor as yourself. That is much more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices." And who organizes and mediates the burnt sacrifices but the religious authorities? To love God and love one's neighbor is something we can all do. We don't need special people to help mediate for us. It's simple. It's clear. Love God, and that love is shown through how we treat others. It's simple. We as Christians love to hear that. I do, anyway. We listen to Jesus and feel the immediacy of what he's saying to us. Love God, love your neighbor as yourself. We all know it. And yes, I think we all know the story of the Good Samaritan, in which a traveler is viciously attacked and left for dead. A priest actually crosses the road to avoid helping him, and another religious person does the same. Finally, a Samaritan, who is a lowly outsider, a stranger, takes care of the man. Who, Jesus asks, is the man's neighbor? Those of his ethnic or religious group, or the one who offered aid? The story teaches us that our neighbor is not just those closest to us, but those who we might consider other. In other words, everyone. As Christians, we tend to look at love your neighbor as an invitation to help and aid others, as a way of showing our love for God through how we treat them. I have a very good friend named Grace, and she will probably be coming up this spring. I hope you will all meet her. She's a social activist, she's a community organizer, and she's probably one of the most faithful Christians I've ever met. She used to help with our Sunday school for grandchildren who were regular attendees, and she organized field trips to the river and to the beach. And we also served on the mission team together. She's very opinionated, so of course I love her. But she used to confuse me sometimes. Well, maybe not confuse is exactly right, but I didn't fully or understand where she was coming from. In our mission meeting, she'd say things like, "We need to do more than charity." "What good is that?" Things like that. "We need to do something," she'd say. But she wouldn't really explain. Knowing her as I did, I had an idea of what she meant. That we should be active, not passive, to try to enact some kind of meaningful change. But it took until this week for me to finally get at the theology behind Grace's comments about we need to stop just giving handouts, we need to do something, we need to get up and do something. What it was about charitable giving that was bothering her, it was actually at the core of her belief system. This week, I was reading an article in Sojourner's magazine by Adam Joyce. In it, he suggests that our typical expression of loving our neighbor, for instance, donating money to the soup kitchen, really doesn't do much more than cement an oppressive system. In other words, "I am Lady Bountiful. Here are some crumbs. I will remain Lady Bountiful. You will need to keep begging me for crumbs. And I will give you what crumbs I can." And that's a bit paternalistic, isn't it? In our context as white middle-class Christians, we enter into loving our neighbor from a position of privilege and power. And I don't even think we're aware of it, that we are inadvertently keeping a power dynamic going. We can simply keep giving money, food, and other band-aid type of help, but it doesn't change the situation for those who are experiencing poverty, addiction, homelessness, mental illness, and the very deep and very real scars left by an inherently racist system. It's important to support organizations that help the vulnerable. I'm not saying that it isn't. But as Grace kept banging on about, we need to do something about the system, about the system that oppresses and injures. This is Reformation Sunday, reform. I believe, if we believe that God is still speaking, what is God saying to us? Joyce writes, loving your neighbor is not an act of philanthropic charity, but it is a struggle to rebuild the world. That's what was behind what Grace was saying that I wasn't getting. Jesus took on an oppressive system. He took on the status quo. In his story, the Samaritan bucked the system, ignored the status quo. Love your God with your heart, your mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. In recent years, many pastors have spent a lot of time talking about the need to love ourselves before we can love others. But I see loving yourself, your neighbor as yourself as really another iteration of the Golden Rule. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. If someone was abusing you, would you want someone to stand up for you? If you are working 40 hours a week and not able to make your rent, would you want someone to help change the system? It drives me nuts that these past couple of years we've been calling frontline workers and healthcare workers heroes, but we're not paying them appropriately and we're not treating them humanely. Love your neighbor as yourself. Don't we all want to work for a living wage? Don't we all want to be able to take our kids to the doctors, have a decent place to live, and access to a good education? Being a good neighbor means that we don't take that for granted in our lives, and we do what we can for those who are not being served by the system. We do what we can for those who the system works to oppress. The scribe took a risk by engaging Jesus. He risked his position and his privilege. Martin Luther risked his position. He was excommunicated. Jesus shook the very foundations of the establishment, and we all know what happened. Being a good neighbor requires more than a handout. It's risky. To be a good neighbor means being willing to dismantle systems that we unjustly benefit from. It's not easy, and it is not comfortable. We are a church which believes that God is still speaking and listens for God's voice and watches for God's action in the world. What is God calling us to do, to be? By embracing Reformation, how can we help create God's kingdom here on earth? Amen. Our second hymn this morning is in the Pilgrim Hymnal, number 308, if you 306, pardon me, if you want to follow along, for all the saints.
Thank you.
hospice. She's an amazing spirit. I visited her yesterday. She is one of God's most faithful servants. She welcomes greeting cards, but please no extra phone calls. She asks for special prayers of patience, so please remember her this week and going forward in your prayers. Do we have other joys? Do we have other concerns that you would like the congregation to pray with you about this week? Hearing none, let us pray. Gracious God, wonderful Creator, Holy One, we are thankful for the opportunity to be together in person, to be with each other in the spirit of your love and compassion, O God of peace. We come before you in prayer, lifting to you our joys and concerns, the hopes and dreams of our lives. May we also be open to your voice in our lives, that we may see with new eyes and hear with new ears. This morning, we pray especially for everyone affected by the coronavirus. As the pandemic stretches on, we offer prayers of support and gratitude to our healthcare workers, our frontline workers. We pray for our friends who live safe but isolated lives, Flossie, Mary, and Edith, to name a few. Let them know that they are close to our hearts. This morning we pray especially for Edith and her family as they begin a new journey. May they feel our love and know that it comes from you, O Holy One. We send prayers of soothing and healing to Alice and Cass. May your love live in their hearts. We pray for Jean and Earl as they struggle together with Jean's illness. Hear our prayer for those whose lives have touched us, those who are in pain, who are ill and grieve. May we touch their lives not only through our prayers, but through our actions. Guide us, bless us, uplift us and hold us, for we are all your children called to your purpose in the world. If you would join me for the prayer Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The final hymn, Lord, dismiss us with thy blessing, number 63.
Thank you. Thank you.